Hey, good afternoon, everybody. Actually, it's early morning, I guess, or start of the afternoon on Thursday. It's about 12:20 p.m. So, you know, things are kind of slow at the office, so I decided to kind of stay home today and take a personal day. But anyway, I'm working on a lot of my Fireforge collection from my Fireforge games. So that's kind of what you see out here. What I'm about to do and what I will be filming is I'm going to be assembling some of my, I think these are the Foot Knights. Yeah, these are the unmounted Templars or unmounted Knights. Now, you can see in the background, I've already got some sets that I've already put together. And I'll kind of quickly go over those and show you what they are. As well as you can kind of see here, I've got some boxes to do probably later this evening. Now, probably by the time I upload this video, it will be evening wherever most of you are at in the United States. But that's probably, I will probably be working on these while you're watching the video. But for now, we're going to focus on these sprues I got laid out here. And, you know, I'm going to kind of show you what I got there. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'll kind of show you the ones that I've already gotten assembled and kind of give you my opinion on them. Okay, these are the Fireforge Games. I think it's called the Mongol Cavalry. And I actually really enjoyed putting these together. I really enjoyed the models and the poses. I think you get about, I want to say, 6 or 7 heads. Most of these boxes have the same number of heads. Most of these come without the helmets on, so you have to put these on separately, or you can leave them off. I had assembled some foot ones, and I've shown those in some of my on the table. So I was kind of familiar with most of the kit. The horses were new. I had never done none of the Mongol horses. Which I actually enjoyed putting the horses together. They were actually fairly easy. They're like a two-part kit, and you add the tail and the head later. But yeah, I was actually quite pleased with the poses you get out of here. So, you know, you've got this guy with his yatagan, which is I think what the Mongols called their swords. You've got this guy with his curved bow. I forgot the name of their curved bows. You've got this guy here with his spear. You know, another saber or yatagan. And, you know, you have different poses. So, you know, they come with a large base. So you can kind of base them in groups, which is how they fight in Deus Vote. But I hate to do that because I feel once I've done that, I can't really use them in another game unless I break them all off the base or buy another box. So normally what I will do is find a movement tray or even build a movement tray and do them like that. But I will probably put these on a better base because they will fall over or tip over. And it's not as evident with the Mongols, but you will see that it's much more evident with my Teutonic Knights. So let's take a look at those. Okay, and here are my Teutonic Knights. And these were actually the first knights that I assembled from Fireforge. I had done the mounted sergeants, which I'll show you in a second, but I had never done the knights. Now, this kit was actually probably the one I was least satisfied with. And there was a couple of principal issues. The first issues is the horses and the figures on these bases is totally unbalanced because of the lances and because of the armor and the shields and the capes. I mean, pretty much if you touch these guys, they tend to fall over, which of course now they're not falling over, but well, there you go, he just went and he took a few with him. But so, you know, you definitely have to rebase these. You can't leave them on there. Unlike the Mongols, which you could probably get away with for a little while. So that was the first issue. The second issue I had was there was a lot of times with the shields here, it was hard to get the shields on the figure and then get the figure on the horse. Because as you can see with this guy, you know, the neck of the horse meets almost right where the shield would normally come down. So you can see you have to build him kind of at an angle. Like this guy is leaning to his right, which is what makes him fall over. But you have to do that so you can put the shield on the base. Because all of the arms and shields are not equal. Meaning you just can't build all of one type. There's different shields, different arms. And so some of them go on good, but you might only have three. And then you have others that just don't go on at all. They're just totally blocked either by the cape. You can't get the shield under the cape. Or they're blocked by the horse. You can't get the shield over the horse's neck. So, I mean, it wasn't a major thing. I mean, it's not nothing I'd give the box a markdown for. But it was something that you should be aware of. Now, actually, some of the shield arms already have the arms attached. And I don't have an example, unfortunately. But, so, that it made it easier in a sense because you didn't have to glue the arms on separately. At least not all of them. But, again, it made it harder because you couldn't reposition it as much. You know, the arm was kind of curled up. Like this one here, you can't tell, but this arm was like, well, maybe you can tell. It's molded onto the shield. So there's really only one way to get that arm under that shoulder. And you can't really reposition it much. As far as the poses go, they're great. I love the helms. I love the comparison horses. I think I did, you get 12. So I did 6 with lances and 6 without. So that way you would always be able to have a front row charging with at least 6 guys. And then they'd be followed up in the back by the knights with their hand weapons drawn. You know, ready to take advantage of the breakthrough created by their peers in the front. Another issue is that these are, I guess they're small. And the reason I say I guess is because I've seen some reviews on YouTube by other people who compared them to Perry miniatures or they compared them to Lord of the Rings figures, and they're about the same size, but they simply felt small to me. I mean, I had them next to some GW figures and it was crazy, you know, how tiny they looked compared to some of the newer Age of Sigmar stuff. So, but I mean, you know, of course that's not the standard I go by or you should go by, but I was just saying anyway. I think I thought they would be a little bit bigger in the box, closer to like GW Bretonians, but they're not. They're much smaller than that. And again, I haven't decided how I'm going to base these. I want to put them on the individual rectangular horse bases that Games Workshop used to sell. And I don't know if they don't. I've went to my local hobby store. They don't have them in stock anymore. The guy that owns the store gave me a few, you know, gratis. But I went online, and some of those bases, which I will show you on the Mounted Sergeants, they can go for $1 a piece. I think Reaper sells them for 84 cents each. So that's crazy. So what I'm thinking of doing with these guys is maybe taking 2 of the square bases that you normally put figures on, and gluing these down to one of them, super gluing them. And then once I put the flock over it, hopefully you won't be able to notice that much that it's actually 2 square bases instead of 1 rectangular base. But I'm not gonna pay $1 per base. So let's look at the Mounted Sergeants. Okay, and this box is called the Mounted Sergeants. And again, you get 12. They come with lances. So, I mean, technically, you could actually just make them into knights, other than the fact that the horses are not comparison, meaning that they don't have the drapery on their horses. But you could literally make them as knights if you don't want to use them as mounted sergeants. There's nothing to distinguish them as not being knights. I think you have enough lances to do all 12. Again, I think I did 4 with lances in this box, kind of just enough for a breakthrough. You know, if you line them up with 6, you put 2 on either end and then some leaders in the middle. You've got the weapons. I think there are some different weapons in here than the other box. Namely, I think maybe the horn and maybe the long axe, which I'm not sure. I think the other box may have had a long axe too. So that one, and I mean, you have a mace here. I know the other box has a morning star. So, I mean, between the two boxes, you get probably most of the medieval weapons you would see. I've seen, like I said, the long axe, the mace, the morning star, the sword, and the lance. Different heads. So if you take a little look here, if I can get you in there, you can see where this guy has the male head covering. There aren't any of those in the box of knights. So if you want to make knights with the male head coverings, you're going to have to take some out of this box, because all of the knights have helms in that box of some sort or another. So these are your sergeants. I mean, really, there's no reason to do that, though. I mean, you could, I mean, unless you just want to put some guys like this, like say you want to put him on one of the knight's horses, then you could build one so that he's on the comparison horse. But other than that, I figured anyway, even if the knights were like in casual, you know, apparel, which as casual as you could get as a crusader knight, they probably wouldn't put all that stuff on their horse anyway. And they wouldn't ride around with the big helm on where they couldn't breathe. So this is how you might see a knight riding, you know, from one castle to another. Whereas, you know, the other guys, these dudes would be riding into battle, you know, in a battle formation. Yeah, but these are the mounted sergeants. All of these are by Fireforge Games. And they basically, you know, they scale up to each other very well. So, yeah. Let's take a look at the sprue. All right, before I show you the sprue or get into the details, I did want to clear up one thing. These are the Teutonic Knights. I have the Templar Knights that I have not built yet. So, I mean, as far as looking at their helms, I think that's the main difference. I'm not sure about the shield, but mostly these are Teutonic Knights. And so this is a box of the Teutonic Knights on foot. I don't know if I have any Templar Knights on foot, but I just wanted to kind of clarify that. So when you're looking at the helmets and the headgear, you know, and you're wondering which boxes it is, these would be considered the Teutonic Knights. But I'm not sure. Yeah, it says that right there on the sprue. Teutonic Infantry is what they call them. So I have, now that's weird because this says mounted sergeants, but these aren't mounted sergeants. You can tell by their stands that they can't be mounted unless you're going to cut their legs off. So these are probably, again, just the Teutonic Infantry, just some dismounted sergeants along with some dismounted knights. But all of these came in the box together. So you get a total of, you know, four on this sprue here that has the helms for knights. And then you get two of these sprues that has mostly your helms or your headgear for sergeants. So you can see those. Now this one is cool. You get some crossbows in there. So that wasn't in none of the box sets. None of the box sets had separate crossbows. And it looks like the swords are separate. I don't know if these are in the scabbard, if you have to put them in their hand or not. I don't think they are. I guess they're just separate as scabbards, because then you have your hand weapons here. But the hand weapons already have weapons in there. These are the sprues I'm going to be working on. And again, I will put these on separate bases once I'm done with them. Probably the bolt action types of bases, the little round ones. Okay, and so that's a look at that. And then other than that, let's get building. Okay, so the first thing we need to do is get these guys off the sprue. I haven't decided, these are the knights. I think I'm gonna do the sergeants first. I haven't decided whether I'm going to, do some head swaps. I actually have a Frostgrave sprue that I'm thinking of using to do some head swaps with. So, I don't know, I'll make up my mind later. For now, I like to get my pieces off kind of in order. As in, 4 bodies, 4 heads, 8 arms. You know, weapons and so forth. So I was going to talk about some of the things that Heresy Productions brought up in his most recent chat, which I actually thought was a pretty good chat. I actually enjoyed listening to some of his views on a lot of the topics. And I'll say 2 things real quick. First of all, I've never heard of Papillion. So I'm not sure if it's something I'm going to try to look up on YouTube or not. I never heard of the movie, unfortunately. I'd prefer just the chat. I don't really, the Q&A stuff, there's a lot of people doing Q&As, and I mean, after a while, people start asking the same questions anyway. You know, how'd you get into the hobby? You know, what's going to be your next project? As with the chats, though, the thing I like about them is they can kind of, you know, it just can kind of deal with things that are just kind of relevant for that week. But anyway, the one thing that he brought up, which I wanted to make sure I commented on in this video, was the idea of creativity in designing or creating war games or games in general, as opposed to studying and learning and, you know, understanding the techniques or the concepts or, quote, the theory behind war games and board games and gaming. And it's interesting that he brought that up because, you know, he's aware of that I've actually created, or, you know, I've actually have games out there. Let's put it like that. One of them actually is a skirmish game. It's called A Fatal Blow. It's a skirmish miniature game. The other one is a role-playing game, which I call a solo tabletop role-playing game, which I, you know, which was kind of, I think it's kind of innovative to kind of touch on what he was talking about. The role-playing game I created, actually, I started on when I think I was 16 years old and I was still in high school. You know, I played this game called Barbarian Prince. And I bought this book called Dragon Quest role-playing game. And, you know, I liked parts of both of them, but neither one of them gave me really what I wanted. So I decided to start making my own game, which is not, I don't think that's very uncommon at that age. I think at that age, kids have so much time on their hands. If you don't like something, you just, you know, kind of take a hammer to it, as in your pen and pencil, and you make it into what you want it to be. But having said that, I think his point was it's better or it's preferable to just create, you know, to kind of pull something out of the ether and bring it into existence, than it is to kind of let old masters tell you, you can't do this and you can't do that, or first you have to do this and first you have to do that. But I think personally, everything is derivative, right? We're human beings. I don't think there's any of us that's ever had an ideal that another human being has not had. I mean, unless you're Jesus Christ. Right. But other than that, everything that any of us think about is something that another human being has already thought about, which is obvious. I mean, when you look at games, when you look at inventions and you think that you're the only one coming up with it, how often do you immediately see somebody else with the same idea? Like, even with my game Journey to the Overland, I like to think that it somehow is innovative and groundbreaking. But there's a game out there now called Gloomhaven, which I think, attempted to do the same thing that I was trying to do, even though I did mine back in the 80s. I mean, I'm sure whoever created it or worked on it had the ideal in his head probably that long. So I think, first of all, you have to accept that everything is in human society is pretty much derivative. Every ideal we get is probably based on another ideal that we've seen or that's been put in our head. Now, that being said, I do agree that if all you do is listen to masters and everybody tell you this is the way it's done, this is the way it always has to be done, that you will never innovate, right? You will never actually create or bring about something genuinely new, something genuinely different. Right. I mean, you look at the Apple iPad, you know, I'm not exactly sure of the Odyssey or the genesis of that device, but I'm very sure that, you know, they probably that was probably not something that, you know, the people in that industry would have said, yeah, that's a great idea. Make a little screen, a little handheld screen, and then sell it for $600 to people with no keypad, no keyboard, and, you know, really no software. You know, but Apple did it. Apple decided to innovate it. Now, at the same time, you can't say that that was totally new, though. Apple didn't put an iPad out of the ether. The concept of a device like that goes back to Star Trek, right? And the tricorder, and the little devices they all ran around with that did all this stuff for them. So it's not like Steve Jobs pulled the iPad out of the ether. It was derivative. It was based on something that was already in his imagination or that had already been brought into his conception. And so as a result, you know, it stayed with him until he thought the time had come and the technology had arrived where he could possibly execute it. The same thing with 3D printers. I mean, everybody's running around saying how great 3D printers are, but most of the technology or most of the concept behind a 3D printer is derivative. You know, you look at Star Trek and the replicators, right? This is back in the 40s and 50s when they were coming up with these ideals of, you know, let's create these boxes that will just give us things we need. And their replicator is still more advanced than our 3D printers are. Because they certainly didn't take 15 hours to make, you know, a hut. So, I think you have to accept that. You know, if you try to create something totally out of the ether, to do something that's never ever been done before, in a way it's never been done before, you create something that has no basis in reality. Right? And what I mean by that is, say you decide, well, I want to do what's never been done in a board game before. Well, right there with that very statement, then you can't use a board. You can't use any dice. You can't have any art. You can't have any characters. You can't use any cards. You can't, you know, there's a lot of stuff you won't be able to do if you're serious about that. And after a while, your board game is not going to look anything like a board game, right? It's going to be some exercise in the imagination. And that kind of brings me to my second, the second point I want to emphasize about his whole ideal. Because first of all, I was really intrigued when he said something about a comic book game. And I think what he meant by a comic book game is basically a miniature game or tabletop game that has the feel of a comic book, right? It's a story. It's not designed to be your team against my team, your man against my man, but rather I think what he's trying to get at is a concept where it's this is the story in the comic book. Now let's play it out, okay? I mean, I guess because even in a comic book, you know, there's certain things you know are going to happen, at least if you're the writer, right? You know, in this issue, you know, say it's an issue of Spider-Man, Mary Jane is going to get captured. There's no option. Mary Jane will be captured. Now, you might still be trying to figure out how she's going to get captured. Is she going to get injured when she gets captured? Where they're going to take her? And so forth. But she must be captured. That's not even an objective. And that would be something innovative. Because I don't think we've ever seen that in a game where a creator has kind of had the unction to basically tell players, and by this turn of the game, this character is basically captured. There's nothing you can do about it. Now, of course, you still would have to spend the whole game trying to keep her from getting captured, right? Because that's what the hero has to do. But the reality is, no matter what you do, by this turn, she will be captured. So, I mean, would somebody play that? And how would you play that out? You know, by this turn, the building gets blown up. By this turn, the hero, you know, is, you know, defeated. And the villain gets away. Right? Would people play that? So, I don't know. I think it's a very interesting concept. Now, to take that one step further, right? And what I mean by to take it one step further is my thinking about when you design or when you create a game, and this is kind of what I've tried to do in the two games that I've done so far. And at least let me put it like this, the two games that I've published. Because I've got a lot of other game stuff that I've never published or done anything with. Actually, sometimes I use it and add it into other games as an expansion or an add-on. But I don't, you know, you don't tell people that this actually was a game in and of itself. But now it'll make a great expansion. But you do that. But my philosophy with that, when I look at designing a game and whether I should study elements of game design, because I have read about game design. I think the first book on game design I read was actually a book by a guy called James Dunnigan. And basically, it was just talking more about designing. It was talking more about designing. This is not flush. It was talking more about designing war games with chits and counters. And it had a lot to do with the probabilities involved. It had a lot to do with the strengths and the variables that you needed to calculate. Yeah, and it was probably more from a military type of instruction than it was more about enjoyment of the game. Because you have to understand, a lot of the early war games were not meant to be enjoyed as in fun. They were meant to be what we used to call simulations. So that book by James Dunnigan, which I think was called War Games Simulations, was actually designed or was actually written to teach people how to create an accurate war game simulation, not how to make a game fun. But, so I have read books like that. I've read books on the board game or war game industry. Most of them are outdated because most of them were written before Kickstarter. But, so in all of that, when I looked at, you know, what it was I wanted to do, which way I wanted to go, so to speak, as Heresy would put it, whether I wanted to be totally innovative and just pull whatever I wanted out of my head and start working on it, you know, and see what it looks like, or whether I wanted to like follow the rules that are laid out. You know, first you do this, you need your concept, you need your scope, you need your depth. You need your components, right? I took it from another philosophy, okay? And maybe this would help, hopefully this will help Heresy if he's thinking of coming up with his own game. This is the advice I would give. What experience are you trying to create? What experience are you trying to bring about? What are you trying to make happen? So, in a war game with chits and counters and, you know, units and layouts. Really, the experience you're trying to create is a simulation of a battle. Or more accurately, the simulation of a commander's decisions that he has to make in a battle. Because you're not really simulating a battle. There's too many vagaries of war that can never be simulated on the table. Right? So the battle is abstract. Whether you roll dice, whether you use a chart, it's abstract. But what you are actually simulating, and what can actually be simulated to a very accurate degree with a good war game, is the decisions a commander has to make during war, right? That's why the war game concept goes back to the 1800s, at least. If you go even further back, it goes back to the days of China and the Chinese empires, and it goes back to, you know, the days of, you know, the knights and whatever. I mean, I imagine there's been some type of simulations taking place since man started going to war with each other. But what you're simulating is not the actual battle. I mean, of course, you want to have to abstract at a battle because you need to know whether these decisions might bring about victory or whether certain decisions are certain to bring about defeat. But the main thing you're trying to create in the simulation of a war game is the experience of being a commander and being responsible for these decisions. So you have to look at that in what you're doing. If you're creating a tabletop miniature game, what experience do you want the players to play? Right? And I'd say 90% of the tabletop miniature games out there now, I don't really think people look at them like that. People don't really ask, what experience do I want the players to have when they play this game? Instead, what I think you see is people say, well, I want to represent this conflict or this battle, and how do I go about, you know, replicating the forces and making them, you know, making them look evil, making them look even or balanced. So the majority of the games is, you know, your guy can do this cool thing, your guy can do that cool thing. You know, you roll this many dice, I roll that many dice. You know, you get this many defenses, I can get that many defenses. And that's why all the games look alike. Because people are not trying to create different experiences. They're just trying to represent different things on the tabletop that really there's not that many ways to represent. Right? I mean, there's not that many ways to represent a guy fighting a troll as opposed to a guy fighting a dragon. You know, at the end of the day, you know, how is it going to be that much different if you're rolling dice? You know what I'm saying? The dragon can't actually breathe fire. The toy can't. The troll can't actually regenerate wounds. But you just put rules in there to simulate that. But still, if you get bad dice rolls, you know, it could wind up being a very boring game. Unless you put things in there where it's not up to dice rolling, right? You make it has to be. And then, of course, you get to cry, well, that's unbalanced. I want to play the troll, and I'm the troll, and every time you hit me and I take a wound, the next turn I heal all the wounds you just gave me. Well, who would want to play that? Right? Because they're going to go, how do I kill you then? You know, well, you have to give me so many wounds I can't heal from them. Well, how do I do that? Well, you need a special sword or, you know, some stuff like that. So, you know, you have to put these kind of checks in there where, you know, you'll get to heal, but only on a roll of 4, 5, or 6. So you could actually have a troll in a game that never heals because the guy keeps rolling bad. But having said that, the question you have to ask is, what kind of experience do you want to create on the table? Because if you understand the experience you want your players to have, and then you can decide whether you need dice, for example. You can decide whether you need a board, for example. You can decide whether, you know, you need miniatures or figures. You know, that's one of the things I'm starting to notice now about most of the Kickstarters coming out, is that you have a lot of board games being created with miniatures that don't even need miniatures. Like the newest board game, Rising Sun. I just sat and watched a 1 hour playthrough of that game. And I will give you my right hand. But there is no reason you needed figures for that game. You could play that whole game with chits. Or tokens or counters or meeples. And it would actually be a better setup for the game board and the gameplay. The figures just totally get in the way. You had these huge base monsters sitting in these little blocks of areas that look more appropriate for a risk game. And people, they're not doing anything. They're just sitting in there. It's not like you put the Oni in the square and says, yeah, this Oni is holding a fire sword, so he gets such and such. No. He's just the Oni. Here's his card. All right, he's there. And you could just as easily just have the card, and you could have a red chit or red token called the Oni token. But the reason they put the miniatures in there is because they can make $1 million if they put 40 miniatures in the box, as opposed to if they put counters and chits in the box, you know, they may make $100,000 selling it to peer gamers or board gamers. And that goes to something that I've been talking about, is kind of convergence of the hobbies now. You know, there's this convergence between board games, tabletop games, war games, and role-playing games. And that's actually a new phenomenon, because when I was coming up, I mean, there was kind of, at least in my part, we used to wish that, you know, you could get a board game with some role-playing game elements, or a miniature game with some role-playing game elements. And nobody would do that, right? Nobody would do that. It wasn't until games like Dungeon Quest came out, Talisman, that you started to see that happening, right? And that's why those games were so popular when they came out. Hero Quest, these were some of the first games to kind of converge or merge, you know, these different gaming styles or these different gaming experiences. But even then, if you went into a miniature game event, you know, with guys like Donald Featherston, Jack Scrubby, Charles Grant, and you started talking about your role-playing stuff, you know, or some of your role-playing elements, man, them dudes would have put you on the first boat out of England. They would have personally had your passport revoked. You know, don't bring that stuff over here across the ocean. So, but the reason I say that is now, you know, it's almost given when you create any of these games that you have to also create something that you can, or some way that you can market it to the miniature group. Whether the game requires miniatures or not, we're just going to make miniatures. So, and I mean, I don't think that's particularly innovative, right? And that's what bothers me about it. I don't think it's particularly innovative. A game like Zombicide Black Plague, oh my goodness, definitely needs miniatures, right? A game like, Blood Rage, you don't need miniatures to play Blood Rage. Again, you could use tokens, you could use meeples, wood blocks, whatever. But I think really, you know, to get to Heresy Productions' point about the creativity and stuff, you know, what you really want to focus on is exactly what experience are you trying to convey? Do you hope to convey? Now, one thing he talked about, which I was very intrigued when I heard him bring it up, was a chase game. And it was kind of interesting that he would bring that up, because that's something I've always had an interest in. A good old-fashioned chase game on the tabletop. I mean, it's not anything you ever really see played out. You know, if you think about it, you never really see a game where there's literally a chase played out. Now, I have some elements of that in Journey to the Overland, which is basically, if you leave a combat, there's an element where the NPCs will pursue you And the way the ruse work, they will keep pursuing you until you reach a town, or until they catch you, in which case they'll attack, or until you get so far ahead of them that the chase ends. Okay, and that's it's a simple element. It's not built into the game, because I do agree with Heresy that you could almost make a game of that in and of itself. Meaning you could literally design a game where the opening scene of the game is your character is right here. He's in the jungle. He's in the city street. And he's being chased. And you have one turn to get started. And the next turn, the pursuers enter the board. Let the chase begin. Right? That would be so cool. Okay? That would be so cool. Now, having said that, again, that's not an original concept, right? That's derivative. And one of the things I'm going to show you as soon as I put another arm on one of these guys is the reason why I say that. You know, and this is just to show that, you know, mostly anything that you think of, somebody else has already thought of or come up with, right? And not, I mean, and sometimes you're to somebody else. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that, you know, you never have an original idea. I'm simply saying that sometimes when you come up with an idea, somebody comes up with it 2 minutes later. Or sometimes when you come up with an idea, somebody else has already came up with it. Right? But maybe you got yours out there first. You know, how many times have you seen somebody come up to someone at a game booth or a convention and say, "Oh man, I'm so glad you did this. I was thinking about doing this myself. I just didn't know how to pull it off. I love the way you've done this." I mean, and people kind of take them comments for granted, or sometimes you look at somebody like, "Huh? You were thinking about, yeah, right." But normally that's true. Normally when people come up and say that, they're not just making that up. They were thinking about it. They were trying to, you know, come up with a way to do it. And so I'm going to, I just want to show you guys one thing, which a lot of you, I guess as the tabletop gamers, may not have seen before, but the role players probably know about it. But it goes to Heresy Production and what he was talking about when he mentioned a chase game. Which, like I said, when he said that, I was like fascinated. I was like, "Oh wow, that would be cool." Okay, so I got his arm on. Okay, I'm back. So this is what I was talking about. Chase cards, and these are produced by Paizo. I think they're meant to be used with Pathfinder, and I picked these up because it's supposed to allow you to play out chase scenes on the board. Using your miniatures. Now, I've never actually used these, and I really am thinking about doing a demo of how these would work in a game, like setting up a chase and then playing it out with the cards. But let's just give you an example. If we're drawing these, and I think, say you're the one running, right? There's a collapsed tunnel. So, and I don't know, you have a strength check, got a shovel? No, I don't have a shovel. Right. And let's see what's next. An underground river. Is that another way? So I don't know what that, and I don't know, these might not be in the right order. Clothesline. So you run into a clothesline. So you got to make an acrobat check there. Hand over hand shuffle. I don't know what that means. Steep roof, easier than a dungeon wall. So you're either going to climb that or you're going to check for not falling off of it. So you run into a crowded street. You can follow the crowd or out of my way. Then on this side, let's see. Green and slimy. So I mean, these, I'm assuming these are all the things that the character runs into as he's running through the street. And I guess if you're the DM, you would say, "Hey, you've ran into an iron porculus. You know, and what do you want to do?" "I want to squeeze through."
So then you make this escape artist check. So the DM says you made it through. You run down the next alley, about 20 feet up. There's a pendulum swinging, right? Stop, drop, and roll, right? Or is there an off switch? All right, so you turn it off. You turn around the corner. And there's a spear trap, right? And so I'm assuming the DM could literally kind of create his deck. Like if you're in the dungeon, you'd use the dungeon ones. If he's in a city street, you'd use those. If you're outside, right, you'd have this steep hill that might slow you down. Block path, treacherous path. So I just thought that was very interesting because when Heresy Productions brought up the thing about Papillion and he was talking about the chase and really liking to see how that could get played out in a different way, you know, it reminded me of these chase cards that I bought. Now, obviously, if I was to use these in a game or a miniature game or even my tabletop game, I'd have to change the effects, right? Because I don't have all that dexterity and stuff. So I would have a different effect of, you know, when you encounter this. Maybe I would put you're slowed down, or I would put, you know, you're attacked or whatever. But it would be kind of a cool way to actually play out an entire chase just as one game session. Okay, so it looks like I've got about 10 more of these to do, and I've probably been going for 45 minutes, so I'm going to try to do about 5 more. So the last topic I guess I'm going to talk about is actually playing games. And the reason I wanted to talk about that is because I don't know. I get the feeling, especially with a lot of us on YouTube that do the videos, is, you know, a lot of us actually don't get the chance to play a lot of the games, like to actually game. And I don't think we don't game because we're on YouTube. I think we're actually on YouTube because, you know, we're doing this stuff anyway. I mean, it's not like if I didn't have my camera running, I'd be, you know, sitting there playing out that chase game right now. I probably wouldn't. I'd probably still be working on these miniatures. You know, as you can see from all the ones I got done the other night before I turned the camera on. So the question I ask is, when it comes to gaming, is, you know, first of all, it's like, when do you play? If you really look at yourself and you ask yourself, you know, when do I actually get my games in? I mean, do you do it like when you go to conventions? Are you part of a club? Do you have a friend that comes over once a week? Or do you have a set night every week? Because I think really that is one of the things I think that kind of differentiates the tabletop guys or the miniature guys, especially from the board game people. Because I get the sense most board game players and collectors, they actually have kind of set nights during the week that they actually get together and play the board games. Right? And in a way, I think it's actually easier for them as board game collectors because, you know, you don't have to invest in another person's board game to play it with them, right? So if you invite me over to play Zombicide, I don't have to buy anything. If I invite you over to play Infinity, right, unless I have both armies, you know, you have to buy an Infinity army, and you have to paint it up, and, you know, and you have to learn how to play it, right? So I think, in a sense, you find more often that the board gamers actually get in more gaming than the miniature gamers. And so I was wondering if all of us, meaning those of us that, you know, we do this, but we actually recognize that we're really not gaming as much as we like. If all of us thought we could actually pull it off, meaning get more games in. You got to excuse my
congestion. I'm getting over something. If we had a set night every week to just do a game. Because I keep dropping this, sorry. I actually like scheduled that in when I first started on the channel. Because I wanted to kind of commit to it. So I had scheduled in, you know, once a week I'm going to play some kind of game or session or, you know, demo a game or practice some rules. Just I'll set this day a week aside to do that. Now that's probably the one part of my plan that has like kind of failed miserably. I think since I've done this channel, I don't know if I've done any actual game sessions. I've done some rules reviews where I kind of set up a portion of it and just showed you how a turn would work. But, you know, when I think about it, though, I don't know why. I mean, it's not impossible to do that. You know what I'm saying? It's not impossible to... I don't know why this guy's arm is like this. It's like kind of going over his chest or something. I mean, I don't have the slightest idea what that's supposed to be doing up there at that angle. That's weird. And his crossbow's angle is weird. That's weird. Taking those off. Well, what I was saying is, I don't think it's all that impossible, right? But it seems to never happen. You know, every time that day of the week comes and I says, you know, this is going to be the week I get a game demo in. This is going to be the week I play this or play that. It just doesn't happen. And so I wonder if more of us decided that, hey, we're going to do this on Wednesdays. Like, Wednesdays will now be the nights that we all agree we're going to put up something, some game session. So, like, I watch Heresy, and he does a DC Universe game. I then go on there on my Wednesday night, and I say, hey, guys, take a look at my latest, you know, Deus Vote game. Right? I just wonder if that would actually work. You know, if we would actually kind of encourage each other to play more. Because I know I definitely get encouraged to paint. I get encouraged to do these kind of discussions when I see other people doing stuff like that. And to be honest with you, I get encouraged to play stuff when I see people playing stuff. I mean, probably with the exception of Gorilla Miniatures. Because, I mean, that guy just, he plays so much, I don't even, you know, I don't even dare to think I could get in as many games as he does. But I don't know. That's just something I kind of wanted to throw out there, is whether or not, you know, it would be kind of possible to kind of come up with, this ideal of, you know, we all agree we need to do more gaming. So let's all get together and make it happen, so to speak. I think that would be a good idea. I don't know. And I think the last thing I'm going to talk about is just some general thoughts on my channel, my YouTube channel. Because you know, I try to keep track of, you know, the subscribers. And it's kind of funny because I've been doing this channel now in this format for about a year. Now, let me show you this. So, this is actually a Frostgrave head. If this is a focus, that I'm trying to get on one of these Fireforge basis figures. And you can see that that's totally, well, it's out of scale.
The neck has that big bulge there because it's a different slot for Frostgrave. And, you know, then the other neck is just protruding way up like an ostrich. So I'm not going to be able to, do any head swaps with my Frostgrave sets. So, you know, in case any of you were thinking of buying both boxes and doing that, I'll let you know right now that's not going to work. So it's back to the boxes that come with the heads that come in the box. But, you know, so I know, like, I'll see somebody that comes up, like, say, with a board game channel. And they'll start their channel, say, in January. And, like, by March, they have, like, 500 subscribers. And I think what I've come to realize is, if you do only one thing, like you say you do a channel and all you do every day is board game stuff. You know, here's a board game review. Right? Or you do a channel like Tabletop Minions and all you do is commentary. You just come on every week, a couple of times a week. Actually, I only think Tabletop Minions comes on a couple of times a week. Comes on, you know, every other week. You know, then maybe once during the week, and that's not always, right? I think if you do that, you'll actually get more subscribers. Because you're only doing one thing, you become known for that one thing, and people will subscribe and stick around, right? Because I'll get a lot of people that, I don't know why, but they'll subscribe and then unsubscribe, which is kind of dumb, but I guess, I don't know, maybe they just subscribe because they don't want to forget to watch something, and after they watch it, they unsubscribe. Which, I mean, you can do that, but I just, you know, you can just put it in your watch later. But, so I was like, well, maybe if all I did was, you know, build miniatures. Like, every week, it's three times a week I come on, I build miniatures. You know, would my subscribers go up? Or if all I did was paint. You know, I showed off my painting. I painted on camera, and that's all I did. My subscribers would go up. If all I did was battle reports, right? This week's battle report, like Wahoo Warrior, right? Your subscribers would go up. And so as I thought about that, what I think I came to realize is all of that might be true. Right? That you would get more subscribers, that your subscribers would go up. But I wouldn't like that because to me, then it would become a job. Right? Oh, I got to get my battle report up. Oh, I got to get my painting tutorial posted. And it's a job. Now, what do you do at a job? You get paid to go in every day and do the same thing over and over again. Right? That's your job. And the last thing I want to feel like, you know, when I'm sitting down trying to relax or do something is, well, I can't really do what I want to do because, you know, people might start unsubscribing, right? So if I get 500 subscribers because all I do is build models all the time, and I decide one day, well, I'm going to sit up here and paint today, guys. You know, you look up and you've lost 40 subscribers, you know, then what, does the panic set in? Oh my God, I've lost 40 subscribers. I'll never paint on here again. I want to apologize to my fans and my Patreon backers. You know, I'm sorry. You know, and I don't see my presence on YouTube like that. You know, this is a channel where I just kind of share what I do. I share all the aspects of the hobby that I enjoy. You know, and if you want to watch it, you watch it. I mean, if you don't want to watch it, that's fine. You'd be surprised. I actually watch more of my own videos than I think most people watch of theirs. Meaning, I actually will run my videos when I'm doing other things just to see them. So, like, especially my wargaming news videos, I like to watch those because I like to look at stuff that came out. Sometimes I'll go watch the old ones. Because I want to see if there was something I meant to get that I didn't get. And it's like, hey, I got a little change on me now. So what was that game I wanted back in January. And it's so cool to pop that in, you know, and you can see it right there, who manufactured it, you know, and obviously by then a lot of that stuff is out. So I don't think, I'm saying that to say, I don't think my channel will ever get to the point where I'm doing all of one thing. So if you're the type of person and you come to the channel and say, you know, hey, I really like it when he does, I really like it when he does the model builds, but I really wish he'd stop playing that Journey to the Overland game. Well, you probably should unsubscribe from my channel, because I'm not going to stop playing my Journey to the Overland game. I actually enjoyed playing that game. And if you don't want to watch it, just don't watch it. But, you know, if that's why you subscribed and then now you're offended, then unsubscribe. But I don't think I could ever, not at this point. I mean, I might at some point create a separate channel. Right? But I think if I was to do a separate channel, then I'd need somebody helping me. So say I teamed up with another YouTuber or something and we decided to do a separate channel where we did battle reports, right? Or we did reviews, right? You know, maybe we both reviewed the same game during the week and you could watch mine or my opinion and his to get his, right? I might do a separate channel for that. You know, just because it would be fair to the other person so that, you know, they could kind of track, you know, track the success or not success of the series. But I don't think I would ever just stop doing stuff on my channel because, oh, well, the last time I did that, 4 people unsubscribed. I mean, because I don't really, that's not my main motivation on this channel, is to just get more and more subscribers. I mean, I guess it would be nice to have more subscribers just because you have more people watching what you do, commenting what you do. And, you know, it gives you more options down the road, you know, depending on what you want to do with your channel. But at the end of the day, if you have to, like, comply with a certain format, or you have to comply, I'm trying to find a sword, you know, with, you know, people's demands, then, you know, you might as well just turn it into a job. You know, and a lot of people do, right? That's why they give you what you want. But then once they give it to you, they say, okay, you know, it's time to pay me on Patreon now. You know, I've been doing this for 3 years and giving you guys what you wanted. You know, now it's time for you guys to pay me, or I'm going to put all my stuff behind the firewall. No, I'm not trying to get into that conversation again. But, yeah. So, I mean, that's just kind of my thoughts on the channel, in case anybody tends to watch one video but not the other. And then they wonder, why does this guy keep doing this other stuff? You know, that's why I keep unsubscribing, is because he's always doing those Journey to the Overland playthroughs. Well, you probably better not subscribe no more, because those aren't going anywhere anytime soon. I actually enjoy doing those. I don't enjoy putting them together as far as editing them and adding the little, you know, the little opening and closing scenes. But, you know, it's fun. So yeah, I think I've went about an hour. I think that's what me and Heresy kind of have silently agreed, that we're going to try to limit these to an hour. So hopefully, you know, you guys have a good weekend. Talk to you guys later. Bye.